Hello, Salem. I'm your mayor, Chuck Bennett. Summer's in full swing in Salem. We had the World Beat Festival and Make Music Day in June, and this month we're welcoming the return of Movies in the Park. It's always great to see the community come together to watch a fun movie and just enjoy the jewel that is our own Riverfront Park. I know the first movie's going to be July 16th, begins at dusk. Check out the City of Salem's webpage for the full list. Now, I also want to remind everyone about National Night Out, which is always the first Tuesday in August. Since 1984, the Salem community has participated in this annual event to bring neighbors and our local police officers together in the spirit of community unity and crime prevention. Neighborhoods all over the city bring out the lawn chairs and get together for a little potluck and conversation. Some neighbors close the street and make a big cookout with music and activities for kids. This year, National Night Out is on Tuesday, August 2nd, so if you haven't already started planning and register your block party with the Salem Police Department, use the city webpage that appears on your screen. Next, my guest interview is Allan Pollock, the general manager and CEO of Cherriots, Salem's very own public transit operator. He'll give us a quick update on what's new with Cherriots. Well, welcome, Allan. I'm really pleased you're here. It's always interesting to talk about the bus system. It's been four decades of Cherriots here in town. And I say that, we were talking earlier, and I want to kind of go over it. It isn't just here in town or here in Kaiser or Salem. It's really a regional system. Can you kind of describe where you are these days?
Sure, great. First, thank you for allowing me to be here and share some time with you and talk about Cherriots. A lot of good things happening at Cherriots. So many people know the Cherriots buses, and that's our bread and butter service. That's the bus service within the communities of Salem and Kaiser. But you also provide service to the small towns in Marion and Polk counties. For instance, we have services that go out to Dallas, Monmouth, and Independence in Polk County. And then we have a service that goes up the canyon all the way to Gates. Primarily, we serve Staten and Sublimity. We also have service that goes to Silverton, Mount Angel, and Woodburn.
And I can also connect, this intrigued me, I can connect out to the coast, to at least to the casinos on Tillamook Transit, and then do the coast.
That's correct. So at our transit centers, we share that with other entities. So Tillamook County Transportation District does multiple trips a day from our downtown transit center all the way to Spirit Mount Casino, and then you can transfer to another one of their bus, either go to Lincoln City, or you can go up to the Tillamook. You could visit the cheese factory all by bus. Yeah.
And I was asking you, and I tell you a lot about how I hadn't realized how complete this is, I can get home from there as well.
And the same day.
The same day, yeah. That's great. What's happened now with COVID-19 both arrived and is now shrinking in its impact on all of our services? What's going on with the bus service?
Sure. So just like many other entities, Cherriots was pretty devastated when COVID first hit. It hit us hard. It impacted our service greatly. So for the first couple of years, we had pretty reduced service. So when it first started, we were down to about 25% of our normal service level.
Wow.
And incrementally, we're back up to 90% of a normal service level. So 100% on the weekends, 90% on the weekdays. Basically, we don't do any service after 9 o'clock now on the weekdays, where if you remember with the new transportation bill, we're able to provide service from 9 to 11 o'clock at night. We hope to get that back sometime this fall. I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about the great job the men and women at Cherriots did through all this, especially our frontline employees. So, you know, if you're a transit operator, you can't work from home.
Right.
You have to come in every day. And they just did an outstanding job during, at times, a pretty scary time when we didn't understand fully what was going on. But we needed to provide service because there was essential trips that needed to be made.
Yeah.
While our ridership went down, people still rode us every day, going to those essential jobs, trying to get to essential medical appointments, and making those essential trips to the grocery store. So a lot of hospital employees, grocery store clerks, mm-hmm. Take the bus to work. And so for those businesses to operate, we needed to get those people there.
What has happened, just sort of following up on the employees you're talking about, there's also a huge number of employees are working from home. What's that done to your ridership?
Yes, so it has significantly impacted our ridership. So we're today at about 65% of normal ridership, pre-COVID ridership. On a normal month before COVID, we carried about 285,000, 290,000 people a month. Now we're at about 190, but every month since the pandemic, ridership has grown. So we're so we've got the everyday rider and those that really don't have a choice, but those, especially like state and government workers, many of them worked from home, so we haven't returned that ridership yet. And what we're finding, those that have come back maybe 1 or 2 days a week, they're choosing to drive those days. But we're hoping over time, as more and more people come back, we'll start to see that ridership return.
Has that had a tremendous impact on your revenue?
Yes, our fares, so obviously our fares are down. For the first year and a half of COVID, we ran fare free. But we were fortunate. We received COVID money from the federal government, and we used that to replace the revenue loss and to make sure we kept people employed.
Oh, great, great. I know the city council recently approved a budget item to buy passes for students, I think, is one of the things we're getting into.
Yeah, we are looking at that right now. We're hoping to offer a pilot program this coming school year for all school students to ride the bus for free as an alternate, not as an alternative, but as an additional option for students, especially to get to after school activities.
Yeah, yeah, that sounds great. And then they're going to be riding new kinds of buses.
That's right.
Electric buses,
yes.
Is that in our future?
The future is on its way to Salem. So thanks to our federal delegation and our many community partners, including the city of Salem, we have been successful in receiving multiple federal transit grants to buy electric buses.
Wow.
So today we have 10 buses on order. They are at the factory. They're scheduled to be built in December and January. We should get those in February of 2023.
Great.
Assuming no more supply chain issues.
Sure.
and looking to put those in service this spring on what we call our electric corridor.
What other initiatives are you doing to kind of shift off fossil fuels and on to alternative energy sources, or any other actions you're taking relative to climate change?
Yeah, that's great. So we've actually been a leader in alternative fuels, not only in the region, but in the industry. So 100% today of our vehicles, Chariots buses, are operating on alternative fuels. So half our fleet runs on natural gas.
Okay.
Until 2019, it was compressed natural gas, which you would hear about. Now we use what's called RNG, renewable natural gas. So it's natural gas created from renewables, like methane, you know, from dairy farms and from,
really?
From other waste landfills. So we partner with the firm. They pump that in through the Northwest Natural Pipeline. And all of our natural gas buses run on renewable natural gas, which is even more cleaner than compressed natural gas.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, and then the other half of our fleet runs on biodiesel, and we're slowly transitioning to what's called R99, which is renewable diesel. We would be fully transitioned, but there's capacity limits. We just don't have access to enough of it now. So while electric buses are the future, we're currently providing alternative fuel
options
now. You're
going through a
transition.
Transition period. That sounds great. Yeah. What about additional stops, more frequent service, different? Because I know regularly you're looking at the future of the bus system and how it best serves the community. What can we look forward to?
Sure. So we are nearing completion of what we call a long-range transit plan right now to really identify some of those unmet needs. So we have some really great service on the major corridors in the community, every 15-minute service. But there are gaps in areas. Think of it as areas where it's not really conducive to bring a big 40-foot bus through neighborhoods.
Right.
So we're looking at alternatives, and thanks to technology advances, to using different methods. Sometimes it's a smaller bus, sometimes we could partner with a TNC, like an Uber or Lyft, to bring people within smaller neighborhoods into the big trunk lines. And that's where our transit centers come into play.
Right, and you had mentioned earlier when we were talking about new transit centers, one that caught my attention was the concept of one over in West Salem in sort of the general Edgewater area. South, north, I mean, where else are you looking?
Sure. Yeah, so in West Salem, we have one now behind Roth's, but a lot of our ridership is over in the Edgewater area, and we're really looking how can we better serve that area for our riders. But the big project we're working on right now, and our board is working on it this month in a work session, is a South Salem Transit Center and Mobility Hub. So we have identified a few parcels. We're doing the deeper dive now. And what that will do is allow us to create what we're calling a mobility hub. So not only will our big buses that are on the big corridors get to consolidate there, but then these alternative transportation methods. So we'll have like a potential for a bike station, scooters, smaller buses that go into the neighborhoods where there's a lot of mixed-use development, bring them to the hub so they can get on the bus to go wherever they need to go. With one of the major ideas is how can we reduce travel time to get people where they're going quicker on the bus? Because that is one of the barriers of the buses. It takes a bit longer than a car, but we want to give people those options.
But it allows me to integrate alternative uses I may have, which
yes.
It could be, it isn't, but a scooter, or nor am I on a some of the other kinds of transportation. But for people who want to ride their bike mm-hmm. to work, they can hook into a major transit center, ride their bike from their neighborhood a little bit, securely do their bike, and catch the bus into the center of town.
Yeah. So you may live a little bit too far to walk, but
right.
Hey, I can ride a bike, I can get there, you can secure your bike, get on the bus, do what you need to do, come back and take
that. That's just really going to be interesting. When do you think that kind of service will start to exist?
I think it's going to take a couple of more years.
Okay.
We've been banking some of the new transportation tax money that we're receiving to kind of build out the fleet. So we're looking at now different types of buses. So we'll always have the big 40-foot bus on the major routes because we're mass transit and we need to move large amounts of people.
Right.
But to get people in other places, because we want to connect with the places people want to go, not just where the bus goes.
That's great. Now, if I'm sitting at home right now looking at this, where do I go to find out about what's...
I encourage people to go to our website, chariots.org,
okay.
And we have a page on all of our major projects and where we're at on those.
Excellent. Well, Allan, thank you very much for coming in and talking with us about what's going on. It's very exciting. It really does sound like a lot of new and different things coming up.
Great. Yeah, there's a lot of good happening at Cherriots. And thank you again for having me here. And thank you for your service. It's people like you that make Salem such a great place to live.
Yeah. Same to you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Allan.